Hello. Alright. Hello guys, good evening. Okay, my name is Zo. Today I'm going to talk about Flim, which is I think quite cool. So I tried this Flim project last weekend just for my, you know, to play around and testing to see if it works for me or can I use this for my team. So let's move on and let's get started. So who am I? I'm currently working with a startup company called HelloGo. So we are doing mobile app for people to buy and sell food through their mobile app. So yeah, people can download it from Google Play, from iOS App Store, and I'm doing Ruby mostly, doing some blockchain as well, but I'm not so expert, just like Jimmy, still learning, and I love DevOps and I love to automate stuff. So yeah, I'm doing some DevOps as well at HelloGo. And yeah, we are hiring and we can talk after this if you are interested. So what is Flim? So basically, it's like HelloGo, but it's hosted in your own cluster, in your own server. So you manage your own server. And it is an open source project written in Go, just like Kubernetes and Docker. If you guys are familiar with Docker and Kubernetes, two popular projects written in Go, DevOps software. And yeah, the experience for CLI is just like Heroku. So you have like Flim logs, Flim PS, Flim apps. So just like Heroku, but you manage your own cluster. And it's powered by Heroku Buildpacks. So if you guys never heard about this Buildpack, so when you type git push Heroku master, actually Heroku try to build your app at the back in your server using something called Buildpacks. So Buildpacks is actually a collection of bash scripts that do three things. So first thing is detect your environment. So if you push PHP code, Heroku will tell you in the terminal detecting PHP environment. So the second step is compiling your app. So it will do the record dependency installation. So if you do Node.js deployment, it will read your package JSON or package-node.json and try to install all the node packages. Same goes like Ruby, it will detect gem file and install everything inside the production group and all the default group. So it's a very powerful open source project by Heroku. So Ruby is using this what we call Buildpacks. So why not Doku? There's another project called Doku, which is open source project as well for deployment. But why not Doku? It's another great project. So the reason why I choose Flim over Doku, because Doku does not support multi-nodes and Flim support multi-nodes. What I mean by multi-nodes is you cannot use multiple servers to run the same instance of your app. So if you have another server, you cannot join the cluster. But if you are using Flim, you can have multiple servers to form a group of servers that we call it cluster. So that means you cannot achieve high availability using Doku. Okay? So before that, I want to give warning, I'm not using this for production yet, just for staging and dev purposes. So if you want to use for production, go ahead. According to them, in their website, they put it, Flim is open source project that powered apps and running in production, da-da-da-da-da. But to be honest, I'm not using it in production yet. Okay, so why not Docker? How about AWS Fargate? So if you guys followed AWS news on Twitter and over the web, so AWS just announced one project, one new product called AWS Fargate. So AWS Fargate is actually a new product that can power your Docker containers without managing your own instance. So the idea is like the abstraction level of Docker Compose without, or Docker without your own host, without your cluster. You just push your task, they call it task, and they will run the task inside their own cluster, but they will not give you SSH instance. They will not give you SSH capability so that you can, you know, you can log in into the server and SSH and play around with the next steps to the, you know, PS, AUX and everything. So why not AWS Fargate? Okay, so I tried Fargate before and I think it's still not the right tool and still not ready yet for production. Sorry, Fargate, I think in my current use case and my team use case, I think it's still not meeting the requirements.
Is it public or?
Yeah, it's public. So you can go to.
Okay,
so this is the product I'm talking about. So AWS Fargate run containers without managing your servers. So I tried this Fargate thing and I don't think I like it because it's not meeting my requirement. So it's harder for team members to learn because everybody to jump on board to learn Docker and get most of the projects that available online in the Docker Hub are what we call public images. So if you have your own project or your proprietary project, of course you don't want to make it public and you want to store it inside your private Docker container. So it's either you are using Docker Hub, pay for it, it's not that cheap, okay, or you manage your own Docker private registry. And then if you are using this Flink tool, you just replace whatever you have in Heroku right now with Flink keyword and everything should work just fine. And of course you cannot access Edge if you are using this Fargate tool. Even though AWS always claim, oh, this new tool is really awesome, all developers must try it, and yeah. And then there is no such thing called Fargate run range to be migrate or run source. Happen, you cannot connect directly to the Rails production Rails and do like set something against your production using your Fargate Rails also. But Flink offer that thing called Flink Run Rails DB Migrate or Flink Run Rails also. So the task definition in the Fargate is not to create new release. I mean, it's not very straightforward. You need to create something called task definition. So for every version, you need to create a new revision and tell your AWS Fargate cluster to do another migration, to do another deployment using your new revision. And a lot of steps required to create a new version. It's not as simply like git push Flink master or git push Docker master. So in short, I think Docker itself is fun. It's awesome. I'm using Docker in my daily life, but for production purpose and for teamwork, I think it's not ready yet. Okay. And how about Beanstalk? Because Beanstalk also another tool offered by AWS. They call it our own PaaS platform. Okay, it's just like Roku. I tried, but I don't like it. Okay, first of all, because it's very slow, it's taking forever to create new links. Okay, are you using it? Okay, it's taking forever. Like if you are staring at the web UI, it's like keep loading, I think more than 10 minutes to create a new release, so I think just forget it. And they have less at full API, less at full CLI. It's harder for you to migrate if you are using Heroku. Because my team at Heroku, we are using Heroku quite a lot and we are like too dependent on Heroku, and they're like, oh, how to do this in Heroku way? So jumping over from Heroku to less at full platform like this is very painful. And it's not really fast, I think. It's my honest confession. You still manage a lot of things. So what's the catch behind this Flink project? So the website is flink.io, so what's the catch? So if you go over to the website, right? Flink.io. Everything seems like okay after you jump over into this pricing page. So that's the price for managed cluster. They charge you for their management. I mean, they have their own dedicated DevOps guys that can manage your clusters. If you want to manage your cluster, that's the price that you need to pay to them. For 5 users, for each additional users, that's the price per month. So yeah, again, I'm not using this for production and I'm only using this for staging and dev purpose now. So open source is fine for me and my team use case right now. Right, let's go on. So Flink features, they have built-in load balancers. So it, So you manage your own clusters, so you can choose whatever server type that you want. Okay. Heroku is much lower.
Okay.
Because this is not Heroku price. Yeah. Okay. So right now I think for one dev or staging server in Heroku we pay around $30, $40. So yeah, still okay. But for production you might go for that, right? Okay, so let's go back here. So Flink features, first they have built-in load balancers. You don't have to attach elastic load balancers or manage your own routers thing. So the second thing is they have built-in database adapters. I mean built-in database tools that you can provision your own database. So they support 3 databases now, Postgres, MySQL, and MongoDB. So you just click the UI button and they will provision the database for you inside your own cluster, not inside the RDS. Okay? They have some web UI management dashboard, so let me show to you. I think I have it open here. So this is the dashboard. So if you have many apps, you can see all the apps list here on the left hand side. So this is one of my apps. They show to you the process that you declare inside the profile. So I have three process now. One is running two instance, worker is running one instance. They have all the activities. So if you are Heroku users, this is what we call activities. You can see everything. They have database. I'm not using database inside this cluster. I'm using RDS. I'm attached to this cluster. They have routes, so you can have multiple HTTP routes for your apps. So let's say you can have like Heroku.com pointing to the server, staging to Heroku.com pointing to the server, you can do so. So I have two domains. By default, they give you this one, the bottom one, and you can add more on top. And then if you click the logs, you can see the logs, they keep the logs as well. So it's not very nice, but still okay, still do the purpose. And you can also pipe all the logs to the third party software like AppleTrail, log entries, or whatnot. So this is a database tool that I'm talking about. So you can provision your own database, or they have Redis as well, and you can provision, and the database is inside your clusters. If for some reason you destroy your cluster, everything will be gone. So make sure that you backup or do some schedule tasks that can always backup your database. They have like service monitoring at the back. I'm not sure why my MariaDB and MongoDB is down now. Everything else is okay. And yeah, that's what it's about. So let's go back here. Support Docker, so you can push your Docker containers as well to your main cluster. It's auto-generate SSL for you. I'm not sure, I think they are using Let's Encrypt at the back. And then it support profile, just like Heroku. So this is an example of a profile. I think most of the Heroku users or Foreman users know about this. So you declare process types that you have and just like Foreman start, or inside your development, you call it Foreman start, right? Inside the cloud, you just declare this, and Heroku will detect the profile and run the process for you. So in Flink also, Flink will detect this profile and run the process for you. So installation is quite easy. You just follow the installation guide here. Right, they put everything here. Or I created a simple script which I put inside my GIS. So it's one liner script. You just run that sudo bash this URL to your server and it will do everything. So it's very, I think it can save the time, but it support one node, single node for now. I'm not doing it for multiple nodes. So your favorite CLI commands, this is the equivalent command. So Heroku apps, they call it Flink apps. The only thing that is quite obvious is Heroku add-ons, they call it Flink resource. Config, they call it env. Domains, they call it routes, and then process scale, that Heroku, you need to go Heroku PS colon scale, and Flink, they call it just Flink scale, and process type equal to 2, 3, or whatever number you want. How about cron job? Okay, this is my favorite topic in any deployment course. Like, yeah, how do cron job or schedule tasks? There is no such thing called Flink scheduler to replace your Heroku scheduler, but alternative way, you have your own implementation in your favorite gem. So I found one gem called Clockwork gem. So this is the syntax of Clockwork gem. You have one file called clock.rb. You put it inside your app folder and you declare your task in the form of loop. And actually in the form of loop, like this. So every 1 minute, you call it select job and your select will do something at the back. So this is basically, so what I have here is, this is a sidekick job actually. So every 1 minute, we call this slack clock worker to perform this asynchronously. Okay. So an example of profile clock or cron process, you need to put clock process at the back. So under exact clock work and the path to your clock.rb. I think it's very good gem. So what is the gotchas and the tips that I learned? First is a single node setup is not interchangeable or upgraded to the multi-node. Okay, so I asked them, and this is the official answer. So if you want to have multi-node, set up multi-node cluster in the first place. So you cannot have like single node today and upgrade to the multi-node tomorrow. It's not going to happen. All right. If you are building multi-node cluster, every node that you have deployed after the first server, You must tell the second or the third servers to join the first server as the master or as the manager. So in order to do that in AWS or in DigitalOcean, you must write a script that can auto-join the master, auto-join the leader. So you can do it in bash or you can do it in API call. So there is one thing in DigitalOcean called user data, if I'm not mistaken. So when you deploy Droplets, you can put your user data. User data can accept batch scripts. So in an AWS as well, you can do like a batch script and tell your EC2 instance to, you must run this batch script when you deploy. Okay, when you are ready. So it's only for one thing, not. So if you are using single node, you don't have to care about this. Otherwise, if you are deploying new server, you need to SSH manually into the server and copy and paste your discovery URL. I mean the URL of your first node. Otherwise, the server will not join the cluster. Should we open all TCP or unit ports? You don't have to. You just need to tell your security groups in AWS or your firewall settings to only allow 80 and 443. All other ports will be proxied by this green service at the back. There is no such thing called free login. Then how come when you do git push login master, it can go through? So when you do the cluster setup, Free will give you one long URL that you need to paste into your local machine terminal. So when you run that script, actually that script will generate two files. One file called flim.rc, yes, flim.rc, and another thing called they will change your git config file. So let me show you. For my personal server is fine. Okay, so this is the value of the credentials for the git config. So you need to focus on this part. So if you can see here, this is the path to my PAM file. This is the PAM file that's generated by the cluster when I set up the cluster. And this is the file that contains all the credentials. So they have like TLS pin and key. To be honest, I'm not sure how it works, but it works. So what I'm telling you this. So if someone copy your git remote, okay. So if someone know your git remote and copy into their terminal and they have your source code and try to push like git push free master. So technically it should work, right? Because they know your git URL, git repo URL. But it should not happen because the credential is only inside your computer, inside your machine, unless you are sharing the same credential, and it should work. Okay? So yeah, there is no such thing called free login command. Can I have multiple replicas of cron job? The answer is very obvious. You don't need two, because if you have two cron job process running, you will repeating the same task. So Just make sure you have one replica of background process. So if you are using multi-node setup, two will fail. Okay, I try it. Two will fail. You must have at least three. You must have three. Okay. And then if you are using AWS for your Redis, because I'm a Sidekick user, I'm using Redis, so I'm using Elastic Cache Redis. So this is just FYI for you guys if you guys want to use Elastic Cache Redis. By default, Redis instance in AWS cannot be accessed outside from the AWS. It's only callable within AWS ecosystem. There is a way to do that, but it's quite hacky. So if you are using Redis database for your Sidekick, whatever, you must call it within AWS. I mean, your EC2 instance can call it, okay? But your Linux instance or your Linux instance cannot call it. So there is a thing called import and export tool. For some reason, if you want to backup your apps and destroy your cluster, create another cluster, you can import and export after you create another cluster. It's very handy too. And this is my current architecture or structure of my single node flip cluster. So I have two VPC here. The right side is a Postgres service. And actually, you can put everything in one VPC, but my personal preference, I want to keep database in different VPC and add related things inside another VPC. So you do VPC peering, and that's the security group. On the left hand side, you only open 80.443, which is HTTPS. 6379 is the Redis port. You only allow it to be called within the same security group. If for some reason you have another EC2 instance running inside that security group, that EC2 cannot call your Redis because this Redis are sharing the same EC2, sorry, security group in this free trusted. And obviously, only SSH from Office IP. And then this part here, the Postgres only can be called from the office and the security group of the first MVC. Okay. I don't have a diagram for multi-node because right now I'm using single node setup only. And node issues that I have so far is logs aggregator, they call it sync log or log sync. I forgot, they are sending everything. So let me tell you, let me show you. So if you type flink.apps, so actually you are not deploying your apps only. In your cluster you have many other apps. They call this as daemon. So they have many other daemons. They call it status, they call it discovery, they call it controllers. This is all the apps that are talking to each other at the back to make sure your apps and your cluster are healthy and running. So when you are using that thing called log sync or log aggregator, they are sending everything to your paper trail. So my paper trail get banned over the weekend. So I'm in talk with them to release my personal account again so that I can continue to play around with this. So this is the demo to show you guys. I'm not sure you guys can see it or not. It's like giving everything, so it's blur, so I need you to skip this. And I asked them on Twitter and the answer is yes, it's not supported, and they are recommending us to do the filtering on the paper trail side, I mean on the receiver side. And someone asked the question on December 2016, and that's the answer from the project maintainer. I'm not sure they are going to work on this or just make this as open issues forever. So that's the end. I'm going to do some demo here if I got time. It's right already, but I want to very short demo again. I want to do very short demo. Okay, so the first thing is when you do the cluster, what we call cluster creation, you need to have at least two DNS record. One is a record pointed to your server. Another is CNAME. This CNAME is quite special. You need to put S3.in and then alias to your first day record. Okay, you can ignore these two at the bottom because this is pointed to my apps that I already deployed. Okay, so I have one app here, which is very basic Rails app. Okay, what we call it scaffold app. So this database actually connected to RDS. Okay, and the Redis server that do the sidekick work is actually inside AWS as well. I'm using Elastic Cache Redis. So if I open inside Firefox, if I do Flink BS. So I have two instances of web. I create two replica of web and one replica of local. So if I go to this server identifier, so first time is like 72, the second time is default, refresh again 72. So it's doing round robin from the first instance to the second instance. So this round robin is handled by the field. So nothing fancy on the form side because just like Rails works, okay? And then let's deploy. I have a simple project here. Okay, this is static site, very very simple static site. So let's deploy this together. So the first thing is you need to do flink create, and then let's call it hello static. So when you type flink create, it's like Heroku create. So it gives you git remote. So if you type git remote. So you get one new remote. Okay. So when you do git push flink master, I think every Heroku users know this. So it will. So the code is two files only. Okay. Let's go to the code here. So you have static index.html file. Okay. And we have one file which is empty file called static file. This is how they detect the environment for static website. You must create this static file, empty file. Otherwise, this flink cannot tell that this project is actually static website project. So when you do deployment, is deployed now. So when you type flim route, so you have one route, HTTP route, hello-htt, and that's the full URL. So let me copy over this one. And let's go to Firefox. So yeah, very simple. So how about Rails? Okay, so Rails is quite different because it is a dynamic app, right? So you have to set your environment. So I just show my database environment here because I'm going to destroy this RDS, so no problem. So this is all environment. So database host, environment, what we call Redis URL, which is right now inside the AWS, secret keybase and select web home. Okay, so let's go back here. Sorry, not this one. So I have one channel in my team there, in my team Slack, which is Zoom AWS, just for this demo. So if I go to this project and I go to /slack/sl, okay. So we tap OK, and yeah, you get one message coming from Slack notifier, which is sent by the sidekick with the help of Redis at the back. And how about the cron job? Okay, so right now if you do like Flink PS, right? Flink PS, you only have three instances or three replicas, two web and one worker. So let's start the third one. So Flink scale, I call it clock, and make it one replica of the background job. So when you start that process and run the PS again. Yeah, so I have one clock process, and let's check the Slack, and you have one process every from sidekick every clock. Okay, so it will run every minute. So yeah, I think it's quite useful tool for you and the team to play around. I mean, to save the cost at the same time to just use whatever you have now instead of paying Heroku, because I think Heroku is not really worth it. Okay, so for hobby plan, I think $7 you get 512 MB only. But in DigitalOcean or Rhino, you get 1 gig, right? And then, what else? The reason why we are moving from Heroku, because we are getting more customers and the cost of Heroku per month is very high, and we try to cutting down the cost. And even though you don't want to use this for production purpose, I think for staging, for dev or QA, so I think it's very good. Okay? But the thing is, you need to manage your own cluster. So I think that's all. Yeah, another message from the clock. So that's all. If you guys have any question, you can ask now.